Coming up on CitrusTV's 2019 Lacrosse Preview Show, we'll take a look at the 10th ranked Orange from top to bottom. John Desko and company have a grueling schedule this season, but when don't they? We're bringing you changes to the roster and a closer look at new rule changes that impact the game itself.
And we'll hear from the head of the Orange himself, John Desko, as well as defensive stud and preseason All-American Nick Mellen. Adam and I have everything Syracuse, everything lacrosse here on CitrusTV's 2019 Lacrosse Preview Show.
Welcome to the Ensley Athletic Center for CitrusTV's 2019 Lacrosse Preview Show. With Zach Lang, I'm Adam Unger, and Zach, this is the most experienced crew that the Orange has brought back in quite some time.
Absolutely. The Orange are bringing back 8 of their 10 starters from last season, but before we get into this season, let's see how the Orange fared last year.
3 straight postseason berths have all led to an early quarterfinal exit for Syracuse. Can this be the year that the Orange returns to championship weekend?
Well, after a dominant performance in the season opener, the Syracuse men's lacrosse team ran into a locomotive. 15-3 loss at the hands of Albany.
Confidence is definitely wavering after that Albany game, and how could it not be?
Looking to see some action. Long outlet pass, Ryan Simmons inside! He scores the game winner!
Dordovic moves right, 15 left. He shoots and scores! Tucker Dordovic, 12-11 with 12.4 left.
When the two winningest programs in college lacrosse history meet up, it's generally a classic. This case, not so much.
Now the feed in front for Dordovic. He lost it, picked up by Triboli, who buries it.
Syracuse reaches a new milestone, the 900th win in program history.
Meeting 104 between Syracuse and Cornell is a big red upset.
Feed in front, and it's home! Brendan Bomberry wins it for the Orange in overtime!
The whistle blows, he gets his hands free, he gives a pass off to a teammate, bouncing ball, 1 second shot, score! Navy wins it at the buzzer! It's Joe Varello, the face-off man!
I was very frustrated because I thought we were well prepared in what we wanted to do. You know, we're obviously disappointed to come out with a loss. We thought we played pretty hard too.
Well, it's going to be a battle of in-state rivals in the first round of the NCAA tournament.
A winding shot goes through. Colton Rupp celebrates in the orange end zone. The unseeded Cornell Big Red come into Syracuse and stun the Orange.
Well, it was certainly an up-and-down season for the Orange, and it wasn't exactly up to the standard set in Central New York. But Syracuse isn't losing a whole lot from last year's team. The only offensive production that'll be gone is Brendan Bomberry. The Six Nations native led SU with 28 goals last year, and Bomberry came to Syracuse from Denver to be closer to his son, and he played 2 seasons with the Orange. Now he's playing professionally in Georgia.
While the Orange have the majority of their offensive firepower back, it's the man in net they'll be missing. Damadonna, the local goalkeeper from Liverpool, played a full 60 or more minutes for the Orange in every game except 4 last season. He allowed just under 11 goals per game in his Syracuse career. But let's look at some of the people that Syracuse is bringing back, some of these veterans. Starting with senior Nate Solomon, the All-ACC attackman was 2nd in points for the Orange last season with 37, a personal best over his 3 years at Syracuse.
Another big name at attack is Steven Rafis. The playmaker made a living behind the cage and had almost twice as many assists as anyone else on the Orange in 2018. He'll likely be the lead Dodger for Syracuse this season.
And how about midfielder Jamie Triboli? The 5'11 junior more than doubled his points from his freshman year last season and played in all 15 games for the Orange. Inside Lacrosse named him an honorable mention in their preseason All-American selections.
Switching over to the defense now, Brendan might be gone, but his cousin Tyson Bomberry isn't going anywhere. The bruising senior is back for what will be his 3rd season as a starter, and he'll also help the Orange push the pace now that the NCAA has implemented a shot clock.
Fellow defenseman Nick Mellen has already been named a preseason 2nd team All-American by Inside Lacrosse. Last season, Mellen led the team in caused turnovers at 22 and was constantly tasked with guarding top attackmen in the country, helping him earn all ACC honors. We'll hear from the redshirt junior later in the show.
And last but certainly not least is longstick midfielder Austin Fusco. The captain was honored with number 11 last season and didn't disappoint. He picked up 25 ground balls and caused 11 turnovers last season. So to call this defensive unit deep would be an understatement, but they have a new face between the pipes to protect this season. Our own Carl Moglein profiled Syracuse goalkeeper Drake Porter.
With the graduation of goalie Dom Madonna, John Desko has been put in the familiar position of finding a new starting goalie. He says the competition is open.
I don't want to say anything that's not going to give incentive to the other goalies to keep trying to win that starting spot.
But that isn't really the full story.
Right now it's looking like Drake Porter kind of might have the slight nod. And
the indication that's been given to me is that I'm sort of in the lead.
You know, Drake Porter came out of the fall ahead of a couple of the other guys.
So why Drake Porter? Coaches say the junior has stood out mentally.
He's a very even minded kid, which is a really good trait for a goalie. I think, you know, if he gets scored on, a goalie needs to get that past him, and he seems to be able to do that pretty well.
You want your goalies to be level-headed. I don't necessarily like a real emotional goalie where all of a sudden a goal goes in and he dwells on it. He's jumping up and down, he's mad at himself or he's mad at a teammate. And I think Drake's just the opposite. He's pretty calm.
While he has yet to start a game at SU, Porter says he's already learned a lot in his 2 years with the program.
So coming into college, I mainly just relied on my hands, but I learned that the communication is a huge factor. Because if the defense can play as well as they can in front of you, with you talking, that just gives you better shots to see as a goalie.
Put it all together, and you have a starting goalie his teammates are confident in.
I mean, I've played with a bunch of goalies, but Drake Porter is just, you know, unbelievable. He'll make the saves that, you know, he shouldn't, and he'll make the saves that he should.
But does Porter think he is ready for the spotlight?
Yeah, for sure. I've been waiting my whole life, so pretty excited.
Carl Moglein, Citrus TV.
Coming up, we dive into who's new on the turf for the Orange, dissect a significant rule change for all of college lacrosse, and talk to the defensive rock of the Syracuse lacrosse team. Stay with us.
Did you hear about the pony with a sore throat? He was a little horse.
Can I tell you a cat joke? Just kidding.
Why was the basketball court all wet?
Why?
Because the players kept dribbling all over it.
Where'd the cats go on vacation?
New York.
Welcome back to CitrusTV's 2019 Lacrosse Preview Show. Zach Lang and Adam Unger here. Now, we've talked about some of the guys that are going to be coming back for this Syracuse team, but there are a lot of new guys coming in. Adam, who have you seen that you really like on this team?
Well, the biggest name coming in for Syracuse this year is Attack Griffin Cook, and the freshman is joining the Orange from Jamesville DeWitt High School right here in Syracuse. He's one of nine current SU players to be named a high school All-American, and he also led JDHS to a state championship in 2016.
Truly someone to look out for. Now, midfielder Pete Fiorini is something special. An Under Armour All-American in 2018, the Baldwinsville native made the All-New York State first team twice. The 6'2 freshman weighs in at just over 200 pounds and tallied a whopping 228 points in his high school career.
A couple new rule changes are coming into the fold in 2019 for men's lacrosse everywhere, not just Central New York. And while the crease dive rule might lead to a couple more acrobatic goals, our own Nicole Weaving took a look at how the Orange is adjusting on both sides of the field.
Out of Gary Gate behind. Canaris stuffed it in! Tremendous goal! Gary Gate leaps over the cage and stuffed it in!
Originally popularized by Air Gate, the dive is back in college men's lacrosse. And attackmen can't wait to add it into their game.
Yeah, I'm pretty excited about the dive. You know, I think it brings a whole new thing into our game. That with the shot clock, I think it's really going to speed up the game. It's going to make it a lot more fun, not only for us, but for the fans. So we're all very excited about it.
Even though this move will be fun for attackmen, the real focus comes on the defensive end.
You know, the reason it was taken out was it had a lot to do with injuries, especially to goaltenders.
But most teams were unable to practice working against the crease dive this fall.
We really didn't have clarity on it until the coaches' convention.
The rules committee has decided that the crease dive will be legal in men's lacrosse as long as the player dives away from the goal's mouth. If a player dives towards the goal's mouth, it will result in a 1-minute penalty.
So how will Syracuse work to defend the dive?
The funny thing is, this fall, I thought that I would have to try some new strategies with the crease dive, and I tried jumping with the guys who were diving and stuff like that, but I found that, honestly, it's really not that much different. As long as I'm matching hands and matching stick, and I'm just playing it like I would normally play any in-close shot, then there's really not much of a difference.
Defensemen will also need to make adjustments to limit chances to use this move.
It's going to force our defensemen just to be more aware around the crease, and when attackmen are around the goal, that we might need to send a quick slide because they can dive.
Thus, the crease dive will have an impact on both ends of the field and add some style to the game, too.
If players understand how and when, it could add some excitement to the game.
Nicole Weaving, Citrus TV.
And now we welcome on the set redshirt junior Nick Mellen. Good to have you here. Now, the first thing I want to ask is, Syracuse is bringing back its entire close defense from last season. How important is it to have all these guys back?
It's something that it's kind of a blessing in disguise, because a lot of teams don't have the opportunity to, you know, carry this whole defensive unit for 2 or 3 years in a row. Tyson and Marcus have been playing with each other for the past. This would be their third year playing with each other, and this would be my second year playing with those two, because I was injured my sophomore year, so I didn't play that year. But I mean, just in terms of like our, you know, our chemistry and our comfortability with each other, and it's like, you know, I know exactly what they're going to be doing, and they know exactly what I'm going to be doing. So like, just having that trust factor with like your defensive partners, it's something else. Like, you know, practices go by smooth. You know, we're just so in sync with each other. It's really awesome.
How has your personal evolution played out over these 3 years?
Personal evolution, that's a good question. I would say when I came in my freshman year, I was, you know, I was so focused on my attackmen. This is kind of just talk. This is defense talk that we have. I was so focused on my attackmen that I would lose track of, like, what's going on, like, in the whole team defense. And then, you know, I got through my sophomore year, and I had to sit on the sideline the whole year, and that was able to, you know, allow me to look at the game from a different perspective. You know, I learned like how to be patient. I learned, you know, I got more familiar with like team defense concepts and stuff like that. So I think I evolved. I think I've just gotten smarter over the past couple of years as a lacrosse player, to be honest with you.
So last year you guys went 8-7. This year you have Cook and some new guys. What do you think is the ceiling for this year?
Just our experience with each other. Like, we, you know, last year we had, youth kind of hurt us last year, you know what I mean? I thought that, you know, I mean, this year now, like, we play with each other. We have D1 college lacrosse experience, and guys that are going to be on that field have that experience. And I think that's probably the main thing, you know. And that experience from the older guys can help those younger guys catch up a little bit.
And you've already been named a preseason All-American by Inside Lacrosse.
Nice.
What are your personal goals for the season?
Personal goals is just to get better as a player, keep developing my game. Personally, you know, I really would love to win a championship. That's kind of like an unwritten rule. It's like an unspoken rule. We don't really talk about it every day, but it's just kind of in the back of our heads. Personal accolades, they personally don't mean a whole lot to me. They're nice, and yes, it's like, I appreciate that, and like, it's definitely like something that, you know, I like. It's nice. You know, who doesn't like getting a personal accolade, you know what I mean? But it's not like what I'm here for, and it's not like what I work for every day.
All right. Well, thanks for joining us.
Appreciate it.
Coming up, if you feel a little deja vu when you look at the 2019 schedule, you're not alone. We'll take a closer look at the Orange's slate, and head coach John Desko will join me on the set. Stick around.
Most party fouls are pretty dumb. But if you decide to drink and drive underage, you could lose your license
and your freedom. Underage drinking and driving. The ultimate party foul.
Looking for more Syracuse lacrosse coverage? CitrusTV has top-notch reports, analysis, and info all season long. All of our content is on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram at CitrusTV Sports, and you can also follow along with our beat reporters, Carl, Nicole, and Sam. And for every sport on the hill and so much more, take a look at CitrusTV.com.
Now, the slate for the 2019 Orange team looks very familiar, and it's certainly very interesting. CitrusTV's Sam Rothman has more on the breakdown of Syracuse's 2019 lacrosse schedule.
Looking at this year's lacrosse schedule, you may think you're having deja vu. After opening up the season against Colgate, Syracuse's schedule is the exact same as last year. Same opponents, same order, but a new mindset. With a disappointing 8-7 record last season, Coach Desko's squad has one thing on its mind: revenge.
If you can take anything good from a season like last year, is that you have a lot of motivation to want to get back after some teams that kind of got one over on us.
We're a year older now, so we've had some experience playing these teams, and we have some chemistry built up between the guys. So I think it'll be a little different this year, and we'll try to take it to all the squads that we didn't do so well against last year.
But it wasn't all bad for the Orange last season. SU went 4-0 in the ACC and grabbed key wins against top five opponents, earning them their 11th straight NCAA tournament bid.
By playing that strength of schedule, that's really what got us in, and we had the wins. We had better wins than anybody in the country.
However, there is one major difference in this year's schedule. Syracuse opens up its season in the Carrier Dome and will stay there for the next 53 days.
I don't think any other team in the country probably has that, but it's nice to play indoors and to have the fan base that we do, so I think everyone's looking forward to it.
We get to play in front of our fans, all of our crew. I mean, we're very excited to how about the Orange Nation get a national championship here?
The Orange's first face-off is set for February 8th versus Colgate, but their first chance at that redemption starts week two against Albany as SU looks to avenge last year's 15-3 defeat. Sam Rothman, Citrus TV.
For the first time in well over 15 years, the Orange begins its season with 7 consecutive home games inside the Carrier Dome. The first 3 games are against in-state teams Colgate, number 14 Albany, and Army West Point. The 2019 schedule is certainly no cakewalk, with 4 games scheduled against preseason top 10 opponents. 4 of the Orange's last 5 regular season games are on the road, with the lone home game in that stretch against number 5 Cornell.
Well, here we go again. I woke up, had a cup of coffee, and I felt almost like game day jitters. You know, we're at practice, and we forget to slap those guys in the back when they're doing something well. So we've got to replace our goalie, get a little bit of battle going on there. We had better wins than anybody in the country. That number is a big deal. I didn't want to put it on somebody this year. I think there's some guys that we're looking at that could wear it in the future, but not yet.
So now it's an honor and a privilege to welcome on 21st-year head coach John Desko. Coach, thanks so much for joining me.
Well, thanks for having me.
So let's start with this. Last year's team, the youngest that you've had in quite some time. How did you have to kind of change your approach when you were looking at sophomore attack, freshman midfielders, young defenders, and a new goalie?
Well, we just felt that they had really good ability and that we needed to get them on the field and get them game experience as soon as possible. So we tried to keep some things a little bit similar, maybe do a little bit less than what we had done with some teams with more experience. And we got them out there, and we probably had more losses than a Syracuse team wants to have. But we competed, we got in the playoffs, and we got some playoff experience on top of our game situation throughout the year.
Now, the experience that those guys got are going to be a little different from the game that they're experiencing this year. One of the biggest changes is a shot clock. How is that going to change your approach to the game?
Well, we'd like to feel that our change would be less than some other teams. There, just like in basketball, there are teams that want to use the whole shot clock. They want to take a shot with 2 or 3 seconds left on the shot clock. Mm-hmm. Other teams in lacrosse have had possessions for 2 minutes, maybe 3 minutes at their offensive end of the field. Ourselves, we aren't concerned about the possession time, more about the quality of shot that we're going to get, the opportunity to score at our offensive end of the field. So I'd like to think it's going to affect us less than some other teams, and that we'll be able to play more a style of Syracuse lacrosse and play more offense, especially against teams that want to, you know, hold that possession time.
Do you see defensive midfielders, you know, maybe somebody like Luke Schwosnick or a long pole like Tyson Bomberry or Brett Kennedy getting the green light a little more often just to get those 20 seconds off your mind and get the ball into the offense's hands?
Oh, most definitely. You know, I think in those two guys with long poles you just mentioned, they had goals last year. So we didn't hold them back. But I think the only time you'd want to hold them back is if, you know, what's the score of the game, how much time is left, and is, you know, taking time off the clock more important than scoring a goal?
Now, there's also going to be a shorter transition box. And I noticed a lot of the time last year, you would pull a long pole off that was on the defensive side of the 50 in order to move midfielders on that way. Is that really going to change anything, or is the shot clock and the shorter transition box going to kind of go hand in hand for you?
Well, I think what you're going to see is with a shorter box is potentially some more unsettled or fast break situations. I think that, you know, a lot of teams would run somebody off. If they're on offense, they'd run an offensive player off on the near side of the box, and now a player could come on 20 yards closer at the other end of the field. So you're getting a 20-yard head start by substituting somebody off. Now it's further to get to the box. It's 5 yards further if you're at the offensive end of the field, and you're coming on 5 yards shorter than you were a year ago. So I think the intent of the rule is to try to create more unsettled situations, some more you know, fast breaks, up-tempo stuff, which players love to play and fans love to see.
Now, a couple of the guys that are going to be looking and working with those rules for the first time are freshman Griffin Cook, Peter Fiorini. You're bringing in Jerry Stotts from OCC, all of them right out of Syracuse's backyard. How important is it to kind of keep a grip on Central New York in the recruiting process as the game continues to grow?
Well, I think it's always great if you can keep local guys at home, especially the talented ones. It's with so much lacrosse out there and the spots on the roster being so precious nowadays that you want to take good players. So we're fortunate that we've had such quality players in the area that we've been able to bring to Syracuse. And, you know, it helps with everything. I think it helps with the fan base, local interest. I think a lot of people from, you know, certain areas, they tend to follow the players from their area, their hometown. So I think it's just healthy in general.
Now, the last time you led a team to be just one game above 500 was 2012. And aside from Tommy Palasek and your son, Tim, that was a very young team. You look at JoJo Marasco coming back. You had Derek DeJoe starting to come into his own as a shooter. And then that team played all the way in a Memorial Day weekend. How does this 2019 team stack up against the 2013 team? And how high do you see the ceiling being for this year's team?
Well, I think we've got just as many, if not more, players back from that group. We didn't have the, you know, success the year before that we would have liked, but hopefully that's just all part of the process, getting these guys out there, getting some game experience, learning from their mistakes, and I hope that we have similar results, but you know, maybe win that last game instead.
All right, Coach, thanks so much.
You're welcome.
We've heard from the Orange. Now it's time to see where they stand. On the other side of the break, we look at national rankings and projected starters for the Orange. Stay tuned.
Patriotism. It inspires passionate debate. It's worn like a badge of honor with good reason, because it means love and devotion for one's country. But what really makes up this country of ours? It's the people. To love America is to love all Americans. This year, patriotism shouldn't just be about pride of country. It should be about love. Love beyond age, sexuality, disability, race, religion, and other labels. Because love has no labels.
They'll test you. Try to break your will.
But however loud the loudness gets, however many cheese puffs may fly, you're the driver, the one in control. Stand firm. Just wait. And move only when you hear the click that says they're buckled in for the drive. Never give up till they buckle up.
Leaving hot coals improperly extinguished can cause a wildfire.
Hey guys, it's Smokey!
It looks as if Smokey is going to use the drown, stir, drown, and feel technique. After the first drown, a good stir. Next, another drink. And finally, a close feel.
Is it cool?
Okay.
Yeah. Hey Smokey, catch!
Oh, my bad, Smokey.
Only you can prevent wildfires.
Welcome back to Citrus TV's 2019 Lacrosse Preview Show. Zach Lang alongside Adam Unger. Now, to wrap up the show, let's look at this projected starting lineup for Syracuse. Adam, who do you think is going to be in the starting attack for Syracuse?
We've already mentioned two huge returners at Syracuse at attack, and that's Nate Solomon and Steven Rafis. They're the Orange's two top returning scorers, and Citrus TV projects that Bradley Voigt will round out the lineup at attack for Syracuse. The lefty sniper came off the bench and was on the man-up unit last season, and he had 9 goals and 5 assists to show for it.
And these midfielders are going to be great as well. Lots of potential. Jamie Tromboli, as we mentioned, a preseason All-American honorable mention. Brendan Curry certainly spiced things up a bit in his freshman year last season with 10 goals and 7 assists. And of course, Tucker Dordovic had a stellar freshman campaign as well, scoring 4 goals against Virginia last year during a regular season matchup.
Now, these guys won't share the field with the offensive midfielders, but you'll hear their names fairly often as well. Danny Varela was shaky in his first season as a lead faceoff specialist for Syracuse, but Citrus TV projects that he'll still be the primary option in 2019. Syracuse also has plenty of options at long stick midfield in its second-year captain Austin Fusco and All-American honorable mention Brett Kennedy.
The Syracuse close defense welcomes back its entire starting lineup, including 2018 All-ACC defenseman Nick Mellen, Tyson Bomberry, who missed 4 games last season with an injury, and redshirt senior Marcus Cunningham, who's been a staple on the defensive starting line for the last 2 years. The big change comes in net, as junior Drake Porter is projected to take the reins from Dom Madonna.
And now looking at the national rankings, you can see that Notre Dame has fallen to number 11 after star attackman Ryder Garnsey was declared academically ineligible to play this season. And North Carolina sits at number 15 to round out all 5 ACC teams. So yes, all ACC teams are currently ranked within the top 15 in the country. And number 14, Albany is a team to watch because they could move up in the rankings throughout the season despite the loss of Connor Fields. Tohoka Nanticoke, if he can rebound from missing the fall semester, has the chance to be one of the biggest stars in all of lacrosse.
And in the ACC, Syracuse comes in right in the middle of the pack, but in the national rankings, they're at number 10. Now let's take a look at who's ahead of them, including 4 Syracuse opponents. Johns Hopkins checking in at number 7. A longtime rival lost a lot of seniors, but circle that game on your calendars. And Virginia, who took down Syracuse in the ACC tournament, is at number 6. They're bringing back 7 of their top 8 scorers. And at number 5, Cornell is rocking Jeff Teton. He is back to wreak havoc, an early pick for the Tawaraton in 2019. And the top 4 includes Loyola, who opens their season against UVA. That's another one to look out for. Maryland at number 3 is returning 2 30-goal scorers, including Syracuse transfer Logan Wisnowskis. Duke is at number 2, another Syracuse opponent and the national runner-up in 2018. And the defending national champs, Yale, despite the loss of Ben Reeves, is at number 1.
Now that'll do it for Citrus TV's 2019 Lacrosse Preview Show. I'm Zach Lang.
And I'm Adam Unger. Don't forget to check out our website, CitrusTV.com, for all of our content and follow our beat reporters and at Citrus TV Sports on Twitter for your coverage all season long. On behalf of our entire crew, thanks so much for watching and enjoy the season.